are we doing? Got the air conditioning working in here? My hands have just frozen to the top of this podium right here, which is made out of some aluminum material. Someone pour some hot water on my hands to... Okay, great. Couple of announcements. John Hicks right there. John, our local Slippery Rockian. He has 6 bars of soap that he's willing to donate. And all you have to do is, of your own free will, make a donation to the... Just go over to the donation pot and put something in it. But he will distribute soap. So see John if you still feel like soap is something you want. All right. I have another introduction to make. Just arrived late last night. Pedro, wave. Pedro Menez. He's from Brazil. He's from the Brazil Chesterton Society. Pedro from Brazil. We are looking for any priest who has gotten permission to say Mass in the diocese. If you have gotten permission, to let me know, because we're trying to get a daily Mass going for tomorrow morning. I know there's a couple priests trying to reestablish their relationships with their own bishops so they can get permission. But if you do, if you made those arrangements, please let me know. Otherwise, we'll make that announcement later. Okay. I don't have any other announcements right now. So, tomorrow, tomorrow we will have the evening Mass, of course, but we're still working on that morning Mass. Okay, we're going to be right on schedule all day today. It's going to be a great day. Our first speaker, Charlotte Ostermann, from McLuth, Kansas. She is a writer, poet, speaker. She's written a couple of pretty good books.
Dan Burke liked
her books, so there you go. Is that great or what? No, it's in the Great Stratford Caldecott, too. Souls at Rest and Souls at Work are the two books that she's written, and she cleverly didn't bring any of those with her. But do look those up. And you know, we were talking, Cheryl and I, about... Because the main reason she's here is because we have an important friend in common. And that's who introduced me to Charlotte originally. Because, as writers and speakers, we're always trying to have an impact. We're always trying to have an impact on the people that we encounter. We had a great opportunity of standing up and declaring the truth and trying to affect souls. But... when she sent her son off to college at the University of Kansas, her son filled out a roommate evaluation form, and one of the questions was, will you be having young women come and stay in your room overnight? And he said, not only will I not be, but I won't let my roommates do it either. Well, fortunately, University of Kansas hooked her son up with a roommate who filled out the same form in the same way. Young man from Minnesota named Paul Haverstock. And they became friends. Paul Haverstock would visit the Osterman's house. And as Charlotte said, more can be accomplished over beer and pizza than sometimes anyway else. Because over the next few years, at Kansas, Paul Haverstock became a Catholic as a result of really knowing the Ostermans and seeing the witness that they really demonstrated in their lives. Paul came back to Minnesota, went to law school, and kept trying to figure out what God wanted him to do. This last spring, Paul was ordained as a priest. He went to the North American College in Rome. Marco knows him too as well, because of his Italian connections. Father Spencer Howe knows him very well. And he has sung Mass for the Pope there too. So he's By the way, I want to welcome His Holiness Pope Francis, who's standing in the back, by the way. Go and have your picture taken next to us. We're always grateful when a pontiff attends one of our conferences. So please welcome Charlotte Ostermann.
Because when I take off my glasses, I won't be able to get all your wonderful responsiveness. But it's a choice between the talk or the glasses. So one thing that I want to say before I actually launch into my talk is that truth is symphonic, which Hans Urs von Balthasar said, and I know you know. But it was so beautiful in the talks last night to hear some of the same themes that I'll be developing, and then to realize that the speaker after me is going to be developing this even further. So it's just beautiful the way God pulls these things together. I hope to help with G.K. Chesterton's cause for sainthood. I'm sorry?
I'll get to the microphone.
Oh, a little more? Okay. I wander. Sorry. Power, help me here. There you go. Because a lot of people who don't know him well think, G.K. Chesterton, you know, he didn't teach anything about the spiritual life. And I want to say, as I know that you all know, yes, he did say things about the spiritual life, because he said things about life. And this business of having the spiritual life detached from life is part of what he's here to remedy, what we're here to remedy. So I'm going to talk about weaving all that ideal into the real. And one of the ideals that we really need woven more into our life is the kind of joy that he experienced and that he generates in us. So I'll start with the aim of art. The aim of art is that an ideal or an idea be realized through a natural form. A limited, imperfect, even flawed material is to be transformed into something beautiful which communicates that ideal. An encounter with reality generates a response in the artist, a longing to share that encounter through form. And the making of saints is similar work. The supernatural joy of life in Christ is to be infused into our persons. But we're flawed. We're unable to keep the focus on that vision of heaven in the midst of earthly trials, and we're forgetful of our princely estate. But somehow, the Word of God is to dwell in us so richly that He overflows from us with the childlike, unconscious ease of play. But most often, this possibility eludes us. We're looking with longing at exemplars of that kind of joy that comes from holiness. And we sense with sadness our distance from that ideal. There's work to be done to mold forms which hold intention the real becoming idealized, and the ideal becoming realized. And art forms, generated in the creative turbulence of that tension, the two-way movement of that tension, not only communicate the artist's highest ideals, but are the works by which those ideals are worked into the very substance of his own being. So if I'm an artist, down in the depths of my own being, there's a yearning toward an ideal that is as yet only a positive absence, what Father Luigi Gisani calls a positive absence, the negative space, the negative shape of that thing I long for. When I can see it more fully, I can begin to work it into, to bring it into form. And as it moves toward realization in my artwork or in my life, it's more fully realized in me. To illustrate this understanding of the work of art as the work of realizing both the person of the artist and his highest ideals, I want to discuss three intimately related persons who met on the playing field of life where we work out our salvation with fear and trembling, and you know them all. G.K. Chesterton, St. Francis of Assisi, and Innocent Smith, our lives interwoven through storytelling. Chesterton had, as you know, a tremendous admiration for St. Francis. His biography of the saint is full of references to a poetic, childlike, joyful, abandoned quality of being that Chesterton's fans then see in him. Innocent Smith, the main character in Man Alive, can be seen as a way for Chesterton to play with the notion of what those characteristics might look like in a natural man, not just a saint. The imaginative weaving together of saintly and earthy manhood worked as a means by which Chesterton drew the ideal nearer to himself, into himself as a bridge between himself and the saint he so loved and admired. And of course we see so easily Franciscan qualities in Chesterton. He was amazed at neon lights. He was rapt in the contemplation of chalk. He delighted in a toy theater, played with heraldic beasts and with atheists. He slashed at dragons with umbrella and wit. He considered cheese and lampposts with the artless gravitas of childhood, and he opposed evil with the frank trust that innocence has that all things will turn out well. I'll give a few glimpses from his biography of St. Francis of Assisi, in his own words, into this quality of childlike joie de vivre for which he is also best beloved. Chesterton, in William Audie's biography of Chesterton, he says, Chesterton understood Christ's injunction to become as a little child, as being not a commandment to withdraw from adult reality, but on the contrary, a charge to confront life's complexities in such a way as to transcend them. Above all, for Chesterton, this confrontation involves the perception of life with that white light of childhood on everything, cutting things out very clearly. And in his autobiography, Chesterton said, Christianity is in itself so jolly a thing, jolly, that it fills the possessor of it with a certain silly exuberance which sad and high-minded rationalists might reasonably mistake for buffoonery and blasphemy. And before I go further, I want to tell you I have a handout with all the quotes I am telling. So those of you who wished you could write faster, just don't even write. Absorb it wholly and poetically, and I promise to give you these quotes. St. Francis of Assisi, of course, needs no introduction, but here are some of Chesterton's observations about St. Francis that you can see pertain to Chesterton and to Innocent Smith, too. St. Francis, he says, had found the secret of life in being the secondary, the servant and secondary figure, a freedom almost amounting to frivolity. The whole point of him was that the secret of recovering the natural pleasures lay in regarding them in the light of a supernatural pleasure. In other words, he repeated in his own person that historic process, the vigil of asceticism, which ends in the vision of a natural world made new. Even among the saints, he has the air of a sort of eccentric, if one may use the word, of one whose eccentricity consisted always in turning toward the center. He was not only a humanist, but a humorist. A humorist, especially in the old English sense, of a man always in his humor, going his own way and doing what nobody else would have done. The act is always unexpected and never inappropriate. Before the thing is said or done, it cannot even be conjectured. But after it is said or done, it is felt to be merely characteristic. It is surprisingly and yet inevitably individual. And this is the feeling we have at the end of a book. It couldn't have happened any other way. This is the feeling that we have about a work of art, the inevitability of it. It had to be that way. Now let's turn to the third person, Innocent Smith, who has become, for those who know him and love him, a very real figure through whom we can enter into the same bold, eccentric, impetuous, magnanimous joy that animated Chesterton and St. Francis. As a work of art, Man Alive is not the most complex, the most important, or even the most serious, maybe not even the most edifying of all works, although we love it and we hate to let anything go. It is a short, delightful story of Innocent Smith who, while seeking to keep alive the wonder and freshness of romantic love within his marriage, manages to turn the worlds of everyone he meets, inside out or upside down, to good effect. His presence is a wind of unreasonable happiness, of revolution, full of explosion, rending, disruption, and invisible energy. It refreshes a man like a flagon and astonishes him like a blow. It slaps you with a thrill of bracing expectancy, but is vaguely unsettling, heartbreaking, even threatening. So we have three persons here in whom joy is quite fully realized as a childlike abandonment, uninhibited delight, and innocent overturning of the world. Let's turn to the question then of why art, imaginative poetic form, is helpful as a means by which you may appropriate and communicate joy. If you've read Flannery O'Connor's Mystery and Manners, you probably want to protest right now that art should not be used as a vehicle or a means, and you're right. We must be true to the work of art and not violate it by dumping our important idea on its pretty back in utilitarian fashion. But the nature of forms is to convey meaning, to mediate what they represent, to possess both intrinsic goodness and also the capacity to speak of reality that transcends form. In this sense, all form submits to this essential violation of or limitation of its selfhood. None of it created itself, so it can't help but speak of a creator. The extent to which it, and we as persons are that extent, can submit willingly, and the degree to which it can convey the highest meaning, these are the measures of its greatness. The measures of the greatness of a form. A saint is such a form. A saint is a mediating structure, a form by means of which we can see Christ and man woven together, a ladder that leads up to our own divinized destiny. When I am pierced by the example of saintly joy, by the beauty of a holy life, a yearning opens within me, that positive absence that I've mentioned, a desire to possess that joy, that beauty, that holiness. The saint has brought Christ closer to me in a way. And now what will bring me closer to the saintliness to which I aspire? I need a way to move from admiration to achievement, from Christ's life begun in me toward Christ fully realized in me. A mediating structure, a form, is needed. And of course the church gives us the highest forms. It's less a bridge over a chasm and more a matrix of connective tissue or a ladder of relations that link two disproportionate forms. The goal of sainthood is that something of supernatural glory be realized through a man, and that he be elevated into his own personal supernatural destiny. His greatness involves his own growth into full realization, and that growth involves increase in capacity to willingly relinquish the boundaries of self so that Christ might be communicated. The saint is the work of art generated by movement in the zone of temporal tension between self and Christ, between origin and destiny, between time and eternity. The working out of salvation that we hear in Scripture in Philippians implies both working something into the man and working him up into something. For all this, we need a middle ground, a playground, Chesterton might say, or a stage, if you will. We need a middle term between ratios, like the golden mean. We need a middle term to establish incommensurables in right proportion. We need a mediating structure that can lift the natural man toward fulfillment and also make the supernatural qualities accessible to be lived within a smaller scope, a less mature life, a more limited form. Art is what I think you need. Art, not the mere appreciation of artworks, and not the mere expression of self in paint or words, but the real work of art, asceticism, the ascesis. The real work of art is the work of this middle ground, the territory in which Christ is kneaded into the bread of my own being, and I rise in him toward the full inhabitation of my own destiny. The demands of poesis, artistic creation, that we strive to represent as fully as possible what we have admired, to communicate as truly as possible what we have seen, to give as freely as possible what we have been given, those are the demands of our movement toward Christ. The Bible tells us, grow up in all things unto Christ, be perfect as he is perfected. Be perfect as he is perfect. And that's a 3-time value process. It has happened, it is happening, and someday it will fully have happened. The demands of poesis are the demands of love, to receive wholly, poetically, deeply, musically, and then to represent through the agony and limitation as wholly as possible. Joseph Pieper says, the reason for joy is always the same, possessing or receiving what one loves. Joy is the response of a lover to receiving what he loves. And joy doesn't overflow until you get that response to love going. To develop a capacity to respond is the work of art, is the work of the Christian life. Chesterton said of this love in his biography of St. Francis that it is the key of asceticism, because the man who really knows that he cannot pay his debt will be forever paying it. He will be always throwing things away into a bottomless pit of unfathomable thanks. In his own autobiography, Chesterton warns that things must be loved first and improved afterwards. In Innocent Smith, Chesterton created a lover of men, and he might have been speaking of Smith or himself when he said of St. Francis that he was a lover. A lover of men, Chesterton says, is very nearly the opposite of a philanthropist. St. Francis did not love humanity, but men. So he did not love Christianity, but Christ. The clue to the asceticism and all the rest can be found in the stories of lovers when they seemed to be rather like lunatics, like Innocent Smith. Innocent Smith tumbled into a small boarding house full of men and women, half asleep to their own humanity, to sexuality, to the adventure of life, to the wonder of creation. Like St. Francis, he had found the secret of life in being the servant and the secondary figure, a freedom almost amounting to frivolity. The whole point of him was that the secret of recovering the natural pleasures lay in regarding them in the light of supernatural pleasure. He repeated in his own person the historic process, the vigil of asceticism, which ends in the vision of a natural world made new. He comes to these new friends standing on his head in the midst of his own quest to better love what is too easily hidden in the guise of ordinariness. In a noble effort to remain true to the highest ideals, he allows himself to play the fool. And of St. Francis, Chesterton said, when Francis came forth from his cave of vision, he was wearing the word fool as a feather in his cap, as a crest or even a crown. He would be the court fool of the King of Paradise. Like the saint, Innocent has seen the vision of his city upside down, hanging on a hair of the mercy of God, and thus seen it the right way up. And as Chesterton said of St. Francis, Innocent Smith can only be understood as a poet. He was a poet whose whole life was a poem. He was not so much a minstrel merely singing his own songs as a dramatist capable of acting the whole of his own play. The things he said were more imaginative than the things he wrote. The things he did were more imaginative than the things he said. St. Francis did, in a definite sense, make the very act of living an art. Many of his acts will seem grotesque and puzzling to a rationalistic taste, but they were always acts, three-dimensional, fully realized, and not explanations. And they always meant what he meant them to mean. Had they read Chesterton's biography of St. Francis, the residents of Beacon House might more easily have understood Smith's holding an atheist at gunpoint, inventing games to play with his hat, breaking into his own home, hosting picnics on rooftops, and courting a married woman. Chesterton understood the role of poetry, and by this term, I want to include all the forms of art making. I'm a poet, but I'm not trying to be biased toward poetry, though I am a little. All the forms of art making, as a means. He understood it as a means by which the enormity of reality may enter into the cramped, unnatural, unholy smallness of our disordered world. Here are some of his thoughts that you've heard also from Orthodoxy. The root phrase for all Christian theism is this, that God is a creator as an artist is a creator. If the beatification of the world is not a work of nature, but a work of art, then it involves an artist. What we have around us is the mere method and preparation for something that we have to create. This is not a world, but rather the material for a world. God has given us not so much the colors of a picture as the colors of a palette. But he's also given us a subject, a model, a fixed vision. We must be clear about what we want to paint. We must be fond of this world, even in order to change it. We must be fond of another world, real or imaginary, in order to have something to change it to. So art making characterizes the sphere where characters become lifelike, humans become godlike, the good news becomes accessible in form, impossible paradoxes are resolved, transcendentals infuse form, and form is cloaked in glory, the glory of its nothingness. It takes art to transform being loved, knowing love, even giving love, into joy, a response to the lover. Art is the work play, intrinsic eccentric, necessary superfluous, limnoscape movement, I'm always doing this, limnoscape movement of transformation. And supernatural joy woven into real life is what we're aiming for here, at least in my job. That's what I'm aiming for here. Why? Because in Chesterton's words, man is more himself. Man is more manlike when joy is the fundamental thing in him. Joy is the uproarious labor by which all things live. Joy is, as Marco said last night, the gigantic secret of the Christian. He described the joyous man, the saint, the lover possessed of love, as one who breaks into extravagances, as the Christian church broke into gargoyles. So I want to discuss what it might look like for someone to break into gargoyles. So I want to take an example from my own life and from the life of my own fictional character. There's a little book I'm working on called Elizabeth of the Epiphany, and it chronicles a year in the life of Maria Oglethorpe and her friends as they prepare themselves to be the faculty of Epiphany, a liberative arts university. The story unfolds through various witnesses and perspectives, in the minutes of faculty formation meetings, in the official history that's being written, in a monthly newsletter, in personal and official correspondence. The official correspondence is quite heated at this point. In faculty monographs, in bulletin board notes, in syllabi, in emails, diaries, and even in their frequently asked questions section. Over a good bit of beer and pizza, Epiphany gives birth to various other new things. The Roundtable Readers in Chippy, the Manifest Journal, Le Petit Pois, a petite poetry press, a summer family music camp, and a delicious love story. Men Alive, the Chatter Chicks, the Gaudiamus Challenge, new friendships, a fancy dress ball, Euphonium, the Blessed Order of Elizabeth, one cautionary tale, several mottos, some coined words, some good works, a school spondee, and some actual education. Epiphany is the school where the best teachers are dead and the best students are backwards. Chapters are available if you go to ourelizabeth.org, and since the story isn't finished, changes now and then ripple back and forth in that fictional year. The book actually came to me as an epiphany. I had read and loved Chesterton's Man Alive, but it wasn't until I read Chesterton's biography of St. Francis that I realized how much my own creative work had contributed mightily to working some high ideas into my real life. In parallel with the story writing, I was struggling with what form my own yearnings to be more expansive, joyful, crazy, magnanimous, alive, and upside down should take. On imagination's playground, you're a little freer there in some senses, on imagination's playground with Elizabeth and her gang, I learned to have fun playing with the ordinary materials of everyday life and playing with gigantic ideas that are difficult or expensive to play with in real life. So out of the ideal and into the real emerged the Joy Foundation, my little experiment in distributist philanthropy, through the mediating structure of that fictional university. Joy, the foundation, and joy the joy, brings some of the qualities that I love in St. Francis, in Chesterton, in Innocent Smith, and in Epiphany University into the actuality of my real life. Joy's motto is be small, think big. But it would never have been realized as a reality without Epiphany's motto, semper incipi, always begin, because hope always begins. Joy's real works, so this is in real life now, and they get mixy here. Joy's real works include two Catholic children's choirs, English country dances, a salon where we have conversation at the intersection of art and faith, a lending library, a sacred polyphony ensemble, support for Catholic artists, a drawing class, book study groups, a huge pro-life project, classes, workshops, and the Northeast Kansas Chesterton Society. Like Maria, I got in over my head and then worked it all out backwards. Those people who know me, who have been along the years, they know. Unlike her, I've felt plenty of loneliness and discouragement along the way. What I could build into her fictional life was lots of like-minded friends with time to play seriously together. I have a harder time finding playmates. We both, like Chesterton, like Innocent Smith, like St. Francis, are discovering who we are by fully, wholeheartedly, ridiculously, impetuously being who we are, following our delights, following the books we love, etc. That being, our being realized, involved creating institutions, which sounds almost like the complete opposite of this bubbly, crazy joy we've been talking about. But Chesterton resolves that paradox, or at least he resolved it for me. Chesterton tells us that when people are really wild with freedom, they always must, and they always do, create institutions. And that seems, whoa, weird to many people today. So I want to ask, why? Why do we create institutions when we're free, when we have this exuberant joy, when we want to play with the materials of everyday life? Why do we create institutions? Because we need mediating structures to communicate all that we want to give. In our, and please forgive me if you're Protestant, but in our Protestant culture, we've developed a contempt for means. And the middle ground that we need for the ascesis of becoming holy has largely disappeared from the fabric of life. Means, God gives them by the bucketful. And we can't despise them, we need them. When we begin to see that, the world begins, as it did for Chesterton, just open up. We need them, we need forms, we need mediating structures, we need institutions to embody and hold onto, hold up our high values, even when we're discouraged or cynical. That we need them to link us to other people. They can't always take you directly, right? So they need like something in between. So if I had said, well, Charlotte's giving this party, and Charlotte's doing this thing, and Charlotte's doing that thing, and Charlotte's doing this other thing, people would have been like, really? I'm sick of the word Charlotte. I really don't know how weird she can be to be doing all these things. But if the Joy Foundation does this, that, or the other, and if they all have different names, like the Catholic Creative Salon and, you know, the Circe Corda Polyphony Ensemble, well, then people can understand them because they're all fractured and separated like that. So we need institutions to help materialize us and give us away. We need them to proportion our capacity to give to other people's capacity to receive. And you know that especially if you're a teacher and you have umpteen jillion things you want to teach your students, but your students are still working on building capacity to receive, so you have to. There has to be a proportion. You need, of course, outlier or something to mediate between you. We need them to help our craziness make sense to others. So if I just walk up to the government and say, oh, well, don't charge me any more taxes on my money because I want to give it all away, they're going to think, excuse me, but you're just giving it wherever you want to do fun cultural initiatives isn't going to fly. You're going to have something we understand. So I look for the mediating structure, the form that helps the government to understand what it means to take your money and give it all away is a nonprofit foundation. That's why that happened. We need mediating structures to extend our boundary without violating us. Those mediating structures help say, okay, this is the salon. I'm not giving you my whole life, but I'm giving you this night together, you know, to help make a little boundary there. Mediating structures are institutions, so now including the institutions free men create as part of their works of art. Okay, don't miss that. Our institutions, our works of art, are forms by means of which we can give ourselves away. They veil personhood's mystery and majesty so that others can bear its presence, giving actuality to the glory of transcendental realities and particularity to universal verities. And I have to say, I gave this talk once in a little bit different form at a real academic thing, and by the end of listening, I thought, if I hear the word transcendental again, I am going to barf, because how many times can you say the word transcendental without smiling at anybody? Like, do you get transcendentals are not just academic concepts? Hello, wake up. I wanted to be with Chestertonians who understood that you have to be real, too. Okay. What I realized, back to the track chart, what I realized when Epiphany University, my, again, fictional, but it's very real to me, came to mind, was that friends like that, friends like you guys would be, if we could all be in the same town, friends like some of you have groups like this, would in their freedom begin establishing traditions, rituals, works of scholarship and art, mottos, school songs, and events from the moment their friendship became focused on generating something bigger than their friendship. When they saw that their friendship in its wholeness, in its goodness, intrinsic goodness, it didn't have to be anything else to be good. But when they saw that their friendship could become the context for something super real, instead of just a wonderful thing in itself, they experienced the delight of realizing their own selves in an elevated, in new and communicable ways that did not depend on end results for validation. Chesterton's assurance that a thing worth doing is worth doing badly is so tremendously freeing, because it points to the intrinsic value of things like creating institutions and poems, and away from extrinsic factors such as how well they sell, who awards or credentials them, how many likes they get on Facebook, or whether they can eradicate poverty. Okay, so I'm going to recap so far because I'm going somewhere else. To recap, we've seen how the work of art is the work of resolving the tension between two realities with creativity. Creativity is resolution of tension, resolution of paradox. You need the Holy Spirit's help for that. We can have another talk about that. But that's what creativity really is. This, the work of institution building. This is the work of community building. This is the work of becoming holy, the ascesis, the work. This poesis is the work of reweaving the fabric of our humanity, rebuilding our interior scaffolding so that it can be spacious, designing a Sabbath practice that sets us free, and yes, that's a plug for the book. Okay, Father Barron says, I thought he was going to be here, and I wasn't sucking up to him, but I just really love this book. In the book, Bridging the Great Divide is wonderful. He says, the chief difficulty we face in the church is a lack of imagination, the inability to hold opposites in tension. And I'm like, we've got the answer to that. How do you teach people how to hold opposites in tension? That's a plug for Souls at Work. Okay, the practice of art develops what I call the metaphoric dimension of personhood, the much-needed ability to hold opposites in tension that Father Barron finds too seldom among Catholics or anybody else. This dimension is moving and being moved. It's integrating, homemaking, form-generating movement. And our culture wants people to stay still or go in a straight line at the most, which that would be like being a little dot atomized from the rest of humanity, or at best being a line that's about to snap. We think of education in this culture as this straight line from kindergarten to done. At the end, this is horrible straight line. And in that horrible straight line movement, the human being is flattened. I tell my kids, you could be a sphere, but people are living on this disc world in the middle, this flat world, and they can't see out of that sphere. The stuff under them, the history, the poetry, the numinous depths, is scary. And the stuff above them is extraneous and superfluous, and they don't need that either. They're living like this. people who go in straight lines. And so real form-building, human being-generating movement is like this. It's got this, this is my limniscate movement, okay? I do it to thwart taped talks. I think they understand what I mean. The person is at the center of that movement. That little intersection point at the center of that movement, that's the human person. And that person expands in wholeness from disintegrated dualism to three-dimensional integration, from flattened to spherical, from just communion with Christ to communication and community. As we grow in dimensionality or realization, we become more and more able to take in and to communicate meaning, whether it's contained in words, art forms, institutions, or festive celebrations. So in St. Francis, you have this realization of Christ in man, eccentric, facing wholly toward the true center, roots cut, clothes shed, territory abandoned, wanting only to communicate Christ. In Chesterton, you have what many people would look at and think is the opposite of that, a man deeply rooted and richly dwelling in his territory, properly clothed, and communicating about everything under the sun. He faced that same true center, but by standing on his head, seeking glory to God in profundis, in the depths. I love his Christmas poem, Chesterton's Christmas poem, glory to God in profundis. And they're both facing the true center. And Catholics, the people in general, Catholics, Christians in general, are facing spirituality as though it's only the arrow at the end of that line. And they're forgetting the movement by which the dark and numinous real aspects of life are woven together into a person who has the both and the impossible paradox. So Chesterton was pierced by this witness of St. Francis' holiness. He was moved toward its beauty, and he was willing to work to appropriate it for himself. But he wasn't willing to violate his own being. He realized that the way to that integration was through being himself, not giving up everything. What if G.K. Chesterton had given up everything about himself that didn't look like St. Francis? What would we have now? St. Francis didn't do all this writing. St. Francis didn't, you know, have a beer and smoke and have long conversations. And what would we have if St. Francis had, if Chesterton had thought, wow, St. Francis, I'm going to be like him and give everything away about me that doesn't look like him? We'd have had a skinny guy who didn't look like him at all. Okay. So he wanted that, but he realized that to seek it in the impossible paradox of being himself was the true glory. So in Innocent Smith, you have, and I don't mean to say, I don't read Chesterton's mind, I don't know that he tried to work, you know, holiness into a man, but I see in Innocent Smith this character in whose larger life humanity, Chesterton found kind of an imaginative playground for the ideal of sainthood to be realized in just one guy standing on his head. In my own examples, you have kind of an artist who has asked at one point, why bother writing, you know? And I discovered through my own fiction, because a character in there asked, why are we writing all this stuff? And it hit me. I went, you know, really? What would I say to her? And then I realized through my own fiction what I would say to someone who thought it was not worth writing anymore. Oh my gosh, all the words out there, 99% of the words out there written are written to suck life out of this world. If I write only to staunch that flow, it's worth it. Okay, so I realized through my own creative struggle with what would you say honestly, because you can't violate the art, can you, and put into the mouth of that character some ridiculous and puny sounding thing like, oh, well, you're just Catholic, just offer it up. And be spiritual. You have to grapple with the hardship of what it would be for someone to work hard to write in this world, and does that matter? So that helped me. And you see also in me what would joy look like in me. And so I helped, G.K. Chesterton helped me find those answers. every one of us is saying how profoundly he has affected our life. This is part of what he has done in my life, is help me find the answers. What would that look like in me? So artistic creation, the acceptance of frames, boundaries, limitations, and the creative response to the elements there held in tension, is a way toward joy. I call it a zone of turbulence, because in the territory of both and, the figure and ground keep reversing. Even when I'm talking about my joy, am I talking about my personal feeling of joy? Am I talking about my joy foundation? What am I talking about here? Am I talking about a work of art, or a saint, or G.K. Chesterton, or Innocent Smith, or me, or St. Francis? You know, the figure and ground keep reversing, because in that area of turbulence, where you're learning freedom, it's hard. That's why most people avoid it. So in that territory, the figure and ground keep reversing. The numinous, dense, thick areas keep exploding with light and color. And radiance, light itself, keeps filling with profound, deep, dark mystery. Joy and sorrow become one in that territory. It's hard to figure out where you are. You're standing on your head half the time in that territory. And that's why people avoid it, as I said. It can be hard to figure out if the song is being born or the singer, whether the voice of God is entering into the story or emerging from it, because both are happening at the same time, in the same person and in his forms. So to use a phrase from Dorothy Sayers that I love, it's like the sledding downhill, she says, delight with terror in it. Delight with terror in it, of willing abandonment, and thus of joy. Joseph Pieper, I saw somebody, and I always cheer when I see somebody, another person reading Leisure, the Basis of Culture. Joseph Pieper, a wonderful German Catholic theologian who every word of his you should hang on. But it took me 20 years to chew on his book, Leisure, the Basis of Culture, and come up with my response, which was Souls at Rest. So it's concise, but whoa, is it rich and dense. He wrote In Tune with the World, a Theory of Festivity. And in that book, he developed a theory of festivity. And just very nutshell, can't do it justice, but festivity is at its core, festivity is religious celebration. Because the joy that characterizes it is a response to man's recognition that being is a gift from God, and his affirmation that creation is ultimately good. Christian ritual worship, our Mass, keeps the eternal festival alive in the midst of a world where festival is being corrupted and destroyed, and where man is losing his capacity to celebrate festively. The arts, Pieper says, can help keep the human person in touch with the need for authentic festivals. And so the arts may help him recover his capacity for our Mass, for festival. Okay, he says, speech, art, and festival are all rooted in the affirmation of being, the praise of God. When one prospers or suffers, the others are likewise affected. Speech, art, festival. Pieper's insights offer a way of seeing how this fullness, this full realization of the human person can emerge through speech, art, and festivity, or what I call the verbal, the metaphoric, and the sacramental dimensions of human being. So I've mentioned to you the metaphoric dimension, that's the main turn of my talk. But I want to briefly explore the others. The first, the verbal dimension, is foundational to the person. So none of these dimensions are like, oh, well, you're only one-dimensional. Yeah, that, I don't mean to put down any of these dimensions by referring to them as one or two or three. I mean only to differentiate so that we can make a whole. The verbal dimension is foundational to Catholic faith and the liturgy. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. God is the word. Word resides in us richly. Without the word, we wouldn't have the liturgy of the word. I call it the first dimension. In the beginning was the word. We use the term education for that sphere in which we learn to use words well. We're teaching kids the grammar, the dialectic, the rhetoric. And of course, the sphere of education includes the home, right? The parents, the child's primary educators. Sadly, it also, as Neil Postman has pointed out, increasingly means the media. Most people's education in the world today is done by the media, is the primary educator. The highest, go to the third dimension now, the sacramental dimension of human being, is served, obviously, by the liturgy or the ritual festival, which in itself serves to communicate God to his people. And then each sacrament is a form made of words and gestures, symbols and substances that actually conveys the very grace it represents. Faithful and frequent reception of the sacraments, participation in the liturgy, both Mass and the Divine Office, if you can get a breviary to work when you're out of home, friendship with the saints and prayer all contribute to our capacity for worship, for lived encounter with Christ and gratitude to him. The home, the school, the church, they give place for verbal and sacramental development, but there's less support for the cultivation of the capacity for the giving and taking of material that's contained in artistic or metaphoric forms. Art has largely been abandoned in schools, right, because teachers are tasked with ever longer lists of musts that maybe must be plowed into the minds of children before they get off the conveyor belt. Religious formation or weak liturgical practices may also omit crucial art training. The liturgy is meant to be the primary education of the human person, the liturgy. And where it is deformed, it can deform our capacity for this metaphoric dimension. Art seems superfluous to many people, too many Catholics. Art seems superfluous to many people in the light of pragmatic goals. And unnecessary, really, to many, in the light of high spiritual goals. I've had high spiritual people kind of want to pat me and think, down, girl, you know. Okay, oh, you have a poem. Must you read it? So it seems messy and risky and self-indulgent, even decadent, right? And might lead, if we're not careful, to an excessive demand for freedom or individuality. But without the arts, we're left with only one or two dimensions. We're left with a fractured person, right? Father Behrens' answer to this is to be bipolar extremists. And again, get Bridging the Great Divide by Father Behrens. Be bipolar extremists. And I kind of almost think maybe that's a manly way, is to be bipolar extremist. Maybe the womanly way is to be an extreme centrist. I haven't quite, I'm chewing on that. But I love his image of the bipolar extremist as an answer to this. But I'd rather we be whole, and so maybe my role is to bring you to extreme centrism. without that invisible dimension, that metaphoric dimension, is hard to see because it develops not in a place of formation, but in a movement. Everybody do it. I call it the limnoscape dance. Some of my conferences were all like doing this by the end. With this movement, okay, forms the human person. It's invisible like a mother. It's invisible like an atmosphere. It's invisible because it is a context of hope. We have learned to be so focused on content that we've forgotten context. And context is a huge portion of what actually forms the human person, a context that calls you into this movement that the Holy Spirit's constantly making away and back, that draws you to your destiny. So without all three dimensions, we're not fully formed, we're not fully realized. As we grow in dimensionality or realization, we become more and more able to take in and to communicate meaning, especially in words, but in words, art forms, institutions, or festive celebrations. That growth occurs as we move and as we are moved between the active development of self, you participate, you work, you do the ascesis, and the action of God upon the self. This is the key to Sabbath. You need to learn to be acted upon. And this is what happens in true creativity, that tension, and then not your own bright idea, but your prayer. And then the Holy Spirit comes down upon that tensed, chord or that tenth string plays a note that is a new thing. This is what you become when you become fully realized, capacious for joy, capacious for love. And it happens in this movement. You better stop trying to keep yourself still, because God's trying to grow you, and there's going to be a lot of back and forth. It's going to be a lot of inefficiency and mess in real growth. A person's dependence on Christ, his natural and supernatural formation, and his self-donation are the keys to the fullness of his realization, and thus to the fullness of his communication of truth, beauty, and goodness, the transcendentals, okay, that otherwise just stay up there looking bright and shiny, and they come through us, and Christ comes through us. So my realization is important because in its fullness, it communicates Christ. A person needs to affirm, to represent what is whole, real, true, beautiful, good in him, and to bring then, in the opposite movement, to bring to the foot of the cross every reality that affects him and hits him and knocks him off center. We don't just receive as Christians in this still movement of empty sitting and waiting for God to be realized in us. We receive and then we give. We receive and then we give. And it's in that turning back to the world that we realize it and its needs, the realities we encounter, back to Christ in prayer. He intended for us to fully realize the world. We are his means for realizing the world back to him in prayer. And so we must learn to face it and be responsive and turn it. And we must learn that turning movement as we get more and more strong. We can bear more and more tension. And that's that openness of being able to bear tension. So the innate human desire to represent what's whole in us is the motive force. And it's that desire that calls for artistic expression or creating new things and that develops the growth in us. Now here are a few specific ways that art formation or that formation in art is formational to human beings. So now you're being asked to hold two things in tension, artwork and human formation. Learning to work in art helps you learn to bear tension until it can be resolved creatively, to be free to act creatively within restraints or constraints. Creativity involves resolving that tension. And of course, in visual art, you have positive and negative space. In musical art, you have melody and harmony, counterpoint. You have, in trying to make new foundations, people with competing interests, the making of a new thing. Art formation helps you to see negative space creatively as a part of a composition. Too often we refuse to see negatives. We merely compromise because we've not learned to resolve seeming conflict creatively. Remember that sphere I told you? Many people are living on the disc in the middle, the flat disc in the middle, and they're scared of the stuff at the bottom. It's like, oh, Charlotte, don't say that anything's wrong with the church because the church is the only thing we've got. Well, there's some stuff wrong with the church, and we can face that creatively. If we don't face the fact that in many of our Catholic schools, for instance, kids are not learning to write well, if no one can say that without sounding like the bad guy, then we just are on flat land. We're in flat land. Somebody needs to be able to say, our kids are getting robbed of their ability to work in words, and I want to stop. Okay, that's my, I'll get off my soapbox today. But it's true, and when you say negative things, it doesn't sound spiritual. It sounds negative. Let's not be negative, let's always be positive. Somebody needs to be able to say the deep, dark realities and not be afraid of them and believe that saying them will help us resolve them creatively. Okay, art formation. Yeah. A lifetime. To value. Art formation helps us learn to value silence and interior spaciousness, non-doing, receptivity, holy leisure. Help me with the Italian fare dolce niente. Okay. To use material things generously, as means rather than ends, to be able to give them away freely. I teach people, or tell people, don't sell what you haven't learned to give away. To see persons as works of art, to be received with awe and respect. Art formation helps you to see deeply into things and through them to their creators. Art formation helps you to know the difference between idea and real, and when you're sitting in a committee where they don't, to say that even if it sounds negative, okay, that's another soapbox, to draw others to Christ by means of your own vulnerability and pain, and comfort them with the comfort you've actually received from the Holy Spirit, not the stuff you just offered up and didn't suffer, but the stuff you actually suffered and then offered to God as prayer. Art formation helps you to accept criticism and discipline as necessary conditions for approaching perfection. Art helps you grow in magnanimity and joy through self-demanding self-donation and exposure. Art helps you learn to communicate truth lovingly and love truthfully. Art helps you know how to be a beginner, learn how to be a beginner. I've only got 2 minutes. And so to be a better parent, you started me late though. To participate in the liturgy as in a great drama, a work of art brought to life by the full engagement of free actors. And I'm skipping a bunch of stuff now, okay?
Join the club.
All right, well.
They only heard half my talk.
So we're not all expected to become artists. But that capacity for poesis is a human capacity, not just for artists. So I'll skip what I'm skipping because I want you to hear, let's see, that the greatest artist is most able to bear the tension of all the constraints. There's two opposing tendencies in our world, the one that focuses on forms as things to be grasped, had, bought, and sold, and detached from their historical roots and context, to be used as vehicles for propaganda or worshipped as totems of the artist gods, and the person of the artist being replacing God. But then there's the other one. The opposite tendency is toward anti-form. Operating right alongside the veneration of meaningless forms is this iconoclastic bent that despises form itself as base and insufficient for high ideals or flawed by imperfections. And Christians are more prone to that error, as I mentioned, in the contempt for means in our society. So my plea for Catholics is really fast that you continue to acquire a great education and exercise to develop your skill in the use of words, that you continue to worship and receive all possible sacraments frequently, that you add to this natural foundation and this supernatural grace your own efforts to work in art. Stop just appreciating or knowing all the history of art and start trying to write a poem or a song or a story. You have to do the work. The Assises. I'm going to close because I'm so great at being right on time. No matter what y'all throw at me, I will close with the prayer that now closes all the faculty formation meetings at Epiphany University. This is my prayer for you and for me, for us. Pour forth, O Lord, thy words into our hearts, that we, to whom the manifestation of thy Son was made known by the message of an epiphany, may, by the same presence of heaven in which we live and move and have being, be brought to the glory of his coming into the world by becoming and by creating forms of the Word, where the world may meet him and enter his kingdom.
Oh, God bless you.
Papers with all the good quotes on there that are to give away. But if you want to make a slight donation to the American Chesterton Society, we will not prevent that from happening. Okay, we're going to be back here at 10:30, right? 10:30.